The First Unitarian Church of Salt Lake City. For 133 years, since before Utah statehood, this congregation has proudly championed progressive values, liberal religion, and caring community in Salt Lake. And we are proud to welcome you here today. Whoever you are, whoever you are, whether you've come from near or far, or you're joining us on Zoom, we're so glad that you're with us. On this Sunday morning, we find ourselves on the brink of some new era, when we fear that our most closely held values will be tested to their capacity. We know that it's best not to go alone. Best not to feel alone. We need each other right now. There are those in our community who are vulnerable and need protection. Many others who are grieving and worried. Many with ideas of how to face the times with courage and tenacity, but can't do it all by themselves. Maybe you are all of those things at once. If so, you have come to the right place. Welcome. In a Unitarian Universalist service of worship, we begin by lighting the chalice, which for us is a symbol of wisdom, unity, and truth. Today I light it with these words by Rosemary Wattola Trommer. So, I can't save the world. Can't save even myself. Can't wrap my arms around every frightened child. Can't foster peace among nations. Can't bring love to all who feel unlovable. So I practice opening my heart right here in this room and being gentle with my insufficiency. I practice walking down the street heart first. And if it is insufficient to share love, I will practice loving anyway. I want to converse about truth, about trust. I want to invite compassion into every interaction. One willing heart can't stop a war. One willing heart can't feed all the hungry. And sometimes, daunted by a task too big, I tell myself, what's the use of trying? But today, the invitation is clear: to be ridiculously courageous in love. To open the heart like a lilac in May, knowing freeze is possible and opening anyway. To take love seriously, to give love wildly, to feel the shock of indifference, of anger, cruelty, of fear, and stay open, to love as if it matters, as if the world depends on it. a little breathing in and breathing out for our journey, I invite you to join me in singing number 1009.
You all get nervous every time I stand up. This is one that we haven't done often, but it's very easy, except for when it gets hard. And by that time, we'll know it. Okay? So there are three parts to it. If you look at your hymnal, there's a melody part, there's a descant part, and there's a drone part. We're all going to learn all three parts very quickly. We're just going to run through each part twice, and then we're going to let nature take its course. And we'll do whatever happens when we do it all together. Okay, so here is the first part. Everybody learn it. We'll keep it going until we've either meditated or enough, or learned our parts. One of the two. First part, you're going to do it twice. Second part, come in, do it twice. And then third part, then we'll keep going. One, two, three.
Breathe out love, breathe in 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 love my friends. I am happy to welcome up today's lay minister, who I don't actually see. I'm hoping he's in Ellian Hall. Is he? Oh, there he is. Okay, great. It's like, great. All right. Welcome up our lay minister of today, Brandon Checketts, who will speak on November's lay minister theme of justice.
Hello. Here we are. Something about this week has led me to think a lot about community and safe spaces. So I want to start by expressing the love and gratitude that I feel for all of you and this community and safe space we are creating. I also want to say there is something profoundly healing for me holding hands with my boyfriend in a church. Last week, we heard from Henry, one of our other lay ministers who kicked off this month's theme on justice. As you all might remember, Henry talked about how loaded the word justice is with its many potential definitions, applications, and differing calls to action. He, like me, felt like he was skating on thin ice, trying to unpack such a loaded concept in 5 to 7 minutes. Well, if you felt bad for Henry last Sunday, imagine being me this Sunday. That ice just got a lot thinner. After Tuesday night, I decided to scrap much of what I had prepared for today. It just no longer felt aligned with the moment. Also, before I go further, I want to say that while the results of this election gutted me, as I know it did for many of you, we as Unitarian Universalists are a people of diversity and pluralism. I believe it is possible to hold firm, even be uncompromising, in our values and ongoing advocacy for causes of justice, while simultaneously treating our siblings who may not have voted like us with dignity, love, and respect, some who may be in this very congregation. And as radical as this may sound, to be open to learning from them as much as we hope they'll learn from us. I know it might be too soon to vibe with that idea. I know many of us feel exhausted and defeated. I certainly do. As I carried my sleeping son to bed late Tuesday night, I thought about the world he's inheriting and couldn't help but become emotional as I wondered, when will the arc of the moral universe bend toward justice? So if you're not in the mood for anything other than grief today, that's okay. Put a bookmark there for when you're ready. But ultimately, I believe this is the only way to diffuse the polarization that has turned mothers against sons and neighbors against neighbors. Like Henry, the more I've thought about justice, the more questions I've had. What does justice even mean? There's social, environmental, criminal, and economic justice, to name a few. And how do we achieve justice? What's its relationship to equity, equality, and fairness? I tried to think of a way to unpack all of this in 5 to 7 minutes, but I'm not the one to do that for you. Senior ministers, I'm sending thoughts and prayers. But here's one thing I will say. As a church, we can be on the front lines of helping create a more just world. And how do we do that? I think it begins by listening, by truly understanding with our hearts the lives of those outside our own and acting with compassion. Those who know me know how much I love aviation. In fact, before I understood climate change and the idea of one's carbon footprint, I'd purposely book flights with the most connections. In my mind, it was 3 takeoffs and landings for the price of 1. When I was around 16, I remember flying from Salt Lake City to Phoenix via Denver and San Francisco. I've tried to understand what it is I love so much about aviation, and I think it has something to do with the vantage point. It's the same reason I love hiking and the feeling of summiting a peak. There's something about being in an airplane, looking out at the world below, that makes me consider humanity in new ways. From up there, everything looks so small. Homes and roads appearing as tiny dots and patterns. But when you think about it, each of those dots represents an individual story, a whole life full of joy, pain, hope, and struggle. Think about how many stories one flies over from LA to New York. So I wrote a poem that tries to capture that perspective. Here it is. I often marvel when I look above that 1,000-ton jet in the sky. Call it a bird, if you will. She's a curious thing, packed with people of every kind, effortlessly sitting, snacking, sipping, snoozing, darting over lands others spent years crawling across. Do they look out and wonder? Do they consider what's below? Deserts, forests, mountains, lakes, oceans, and fields, small towns, big cities, webs of interconnected roads, elite, wealthy neighborhoods, poverty-stricken slums, millions of people, each living their own lives, the athlete who just won, the other sent home, a promotion given, a layoff note sent, an inmate's release, another's first night, the exchange of vows, the serving of papers, wealth amassed, bankruptcy filed, the birth of new life, an unexpected death, a burglary in progress, a generous act, a student's first course, another's proud walk, fine dining enjoyed, a hungry family without, millions of people, every emotion in flow, a cluster of seemingly static dots and patterns from above. I wonder if they wonder as they jet across between those two texts, taking off and just landed. At times, all that matters is my point A and B. Other times, I wonder about everything between. Friends, if there's such thing as a just world, and if we're interested in being on the front lines driving such an ideal, I think a good first step is looking outside of our self-serving point A and point Bs of life, making space for and compassionately understanding the real lived experiences of those all around us. This, I believe, will set the stage for a robust conversation on what we can and should do to help create a more just world. I'm grateful to be part of an organization that seeks to do just that, especially during times like these. May it be so.
Months ago, the staff of this church scheduled our new member ceremony, and though you might think we failed to notice that it would be on the Sunday after the election, you would be wrong about that. We did notice, and we realized it was the only possible date that we could do it without disrupting some other important activity. But really, what better time to welcome new members to our congregation? What better time than now, when our society is plagued with epidemic loneliness, to welcome new friends to a place of radical belonging? What better time than now, when skepticism and disillusionment about religion have reached all-time highs, to invite people to share in our religion where questions are prized above answers? Earlier this week, Christopher Robichaud of the Harvard Kennedy School of Government said that America, culturally, has completely abandoned a politics of decency and respect and has embraced instead a politics of resentment, revenge, false nostalgia, and bullying. So then, what better time than now to join a community of relationships where we can practice not only decency and respect, the bare minimums of community, but also the deeper practices of making promises, being vulnerable, courageously repairing mistakes, and bowing to the wisdom in every other soul. In today's ceremony, we celebrate those who have chosen to join our congregation. They have chosen to accept the covenant we share, our promises to live together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. They've committed to support this congregation financially as an expression of generosity, gratitude, and mutual aid. And they've committed to join in our efforts toward making Salt Lake City a finer, freer, and more just place to live. Now, I'd like to invite forward our new members by name to be recognized. When I call your name, please come forward, and if you haven't already signed the book, you may sign it when you come up. If you have already signed it, just come get your goodies. Erica Brown Gaddis. Anna Covington. Maribel Luengo. Barbie Harper. Jonathan Nolan. Tracy O'Berry Covey. Christine Smart. And Christina Doak. Is there anyone who reached out to me beforehand that whose name I did not call? All right. In that case, I'd like to invite forward our board secretary, Kim Grobe, who will lead us in reading together our covenant. What makes us Unitarian Universalists is the practice of covenant, the making of sacred promises that bind us together. Our promises are not eternally binding, like those our religious ancestors might have made. Rather, they must be remade again and again, and returned to when there is conflict or confusion among us. Let us read together our congregational covenant, with our new members joining us in this covenant for the first time, and our existing members recommitting themselves to it. The church shall be a fellowship of individuals with free minds, having for its object the study and practice of liberal religion, including the principles propounded by the Unitarian Universalist Association, the development of a more meaningful life for each member's friends, and the building of a better community and world. Love shall be the spirit of the church, with service to one another and to the largest community its greatest concern. The members and friends of the church do hereby covenant to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in all things, and to help one another. Thank you. You may be seated. I'd like to thank our hospitality team, possibly the most fun team at our church, right? Yeah. For all the work they do to prepare to welcome new members in this ceremony and every Sunday throughout the year. I'd also like to thank Derek Giersdorf, Sandy Green, and Kristen Quinn for teaching our newcomer class this fall. We will have another newcomer class later this year, so if you've been thinking about joining our church, please look out for that. And let us know you're interested so we can notify you when it gets scheduled. Welcome to our new members. Thank you.
I'd like to offer just a few announcements of church events before we go on to our offertory. First, the board needs your help as we begin updating our mission statement and our covenant this year. So they'd like to invite you to join them for a series of congregational conversations about the big questions that are facing us. There are two upcoming opportunities to share your input in person, including next Sunday, again at 12:30, and then again on Thursday the 21st. I believe there's also a Zoom event this week, right?
Thursday,
yeah. So please add at least one of those to your calendar and help us imagine the future of our church. On Saturday, the swap is back. Our environmental ministry's fall swap is on Saturday from 10 until 1. Please bring items in good condition that you can carry in your own two hands. No TVs and no furniture. I know. Also, we're looking for volunteers who can help out with the swap. So please stop at the environmental ministry table to let them know that you're available. On November 20th, out on our plaza, those of you who've been around for a while may recall that we installed a land acknowledgement plaque, but we don't want our relationship with local Native people to stop at a statement. So on November 20th, we welcome Francie Taylor, who is a Choctaw educational consultant and the former director of the American Indian Resource Center at the University of Utah. She will facilitate a decolonization 101 discussion that can help us imagine the next steps in that journey. So if you are a person who isn't content to just learn about decolonization, participation is limited to 25 people who are ready to make a time commitment to our church based on what we learn with Francie. Pre-registration is required. You can check it out at the welcome table. Please bring a shareable snack and $10 to help compensate Francie for her time. There are a few auction items that haven't been picked up. If you purchase, I know, hallelujah, right? Yes. wait, that was Lacrimosa. Yes, we're crying because you didn't pick up your auction items. There are still a few for sale if you need to get a jump start on your holiday shopping, and all of it benefits our church. And Miss Amanda wanted me to let you know that there's movie night on Friday for families, 6:30. They're going to show Inside Out 2. I know. We could all, even the littles, need help processing their feelings this week. So come and enjoy that. If you're new to our church, there are so many activities and opportunities for learning, serving, and making new friends, from yoga and jam sessions to book groups to making burritos for unsheltered Tai Chi practice and so much more. It's all in our email newsletter, and you can sign up for that at the welcome table after service.
Oh, we give thanks for this precious day,
for all gathered here,
and those far away,
for this time we share
in love and care.
Oh, we give thanks
for this precious day.
My friends, one of the beautiful things about Unitarian Universalist churches is each one of us gets to decide how we live into our values. And that's true on an individual level, and it's also true on a congregational level. You see, each one of our churches is its own little nonprofit. We don't have a Vatican or a First Presidency that sort of bankrolls us. We also don't have a Vatican or a First Presidency that tells us what to do. We get to decide how we respond to the needs of our community because our tradition believes that we know that best being on the ground here. That also means that we are 100% financially supported by our members and friends. all of your pledges, all of the pledges you've spent, or the money you donated at the auction, all the money that goes into the collection plate in a very real way keeps us here, keeps us working. So please bear that in mind as the collection plate goes around. You are helping to create this community. And as it goes around, we encourage you to take this time to greet one another as well, especially if you're just visiting us. Say hi. Let's all take a breath together. I think I'm gonna need one more. Before I say anything else, I want to acknowledge that many of us are hurting due to the outcome of the presidential election this week. Though there are no doubt a range of political opinions and alliances represented here and in our wider community, and I do welcome good faith differences of belief and opinion, today I am going to be speaking primarily to those who are hurting and confused about the direction of the United States. Many of us are angry. Many of us are scared, many of us are grieving. And these are all valid feelings. It is right to grieve when you feel something precious has been lost. It is right to be frightened when you are being threatened. It is right to be angry when you feel betrayed. And it is right to hurt when your heart is broken. When things happen that seem unfathomable to us, we so often want to understand why and how they happened right away. When we hear of an untimely death of a loved one, we want the story now. Why? How? I just saw them yesterday. They were so young. How could this happen? And over the past 4 days, I've read many takes about why and how Donald Trump won a second term. Not an accident or a fluke this time, not through subterfuge or insurgency, not even a technical electoral college victory that left progressives with a comforting, well, he lost the popular vote narrative. No, he won the old-fashioned way, fair and square. The popular vote, too, and it did not take days to count the ballots. It was not close. And for many of us in this room and beyond, this fact shakes some of our core beliefs. Maybe it's the belief in the moral arc of the universe bending toward justice. Maybe it's the belief in American democracy. Maybe it's the belief in the American people. Or maybe just the belief that good behavior gets rewarded in society and bad behavior gets punished, or at least not elected to the highest office in the land. And as this has been such a devastating and worldview-shattering turn of events for many on the left, we have seen innumerable takes and think pieces over the past 4 days trying to explain why did this happen? How could this happen? The New York Times says that incumbent governments around the world have fared poorly because people feel abandoned and stretched by inflation and COVID recovery chaos and are rejecting those who were in power when it happened. Of course, it's COVID backlash. The Atlantic says there are three types of Trump voter: the inner circle, using Trump for their own personal political gain; the true believers who have bought into racist conspiracy theories that explain their own financial frustrations enough to support him; and lifelong Republicans who, in essence, hold their nose and don't take his extremism too seriously. Of course, it's the conspiracy theories. People have been duped. On social media, my friends say half the country is evil, stupid, and sexist and racist. My blue state friends want to secede from the union. Of course, people are just bad. Good and evil, easy peasy. The lefty organizations in my email inbox say it's the way the country has always been. We've always been a white supremacist, misogynistic state, and this is just its inevitable apotheosis. Of course, it's white supremacy and the patriarchy. Isn't it always? The Atlantic also says that it would be foolish to dismiss Trump's win as simply a matter of racism and sexism, as there is a very real economic dissatisfaction in the working class and in the shrinking middle class. Homeownership is increasingly out of reach. Debt is skyrocketing. Income and wealth inequality is near its highest point in American history. People are mad, and they want to change no matter what form it takes. Of course, it's the economy, stupid. Bernie Sanders says Democrats abandoned the working class, so the working class abandoned them. Of course, it's always a class thing. The New York Times also says Democrats didn't tell a story about the real facts about post-pandemic economic recovery and Biden's pro-worker policies that was as compelling as the scapegoating conspiracy theories on the right that enthralled millions. People want stories to make sense of their worlds, and Democrats didn't give them one. Of course, it all comes down to narrative. The Atlantic also says the Harris campaign didn't play the new media game. She didn't go on enough podcasts and argue with the hosts. She and Waltz didn't pwn enough conservatives on social media. Of course, it's because they're so stuck in the 20th century. The Atlantic also says Democrats deserved to lose the election because they are just bad at governing. Like, have you ever been to a big blue city? Rampant inequality, unaffordability, disorder, and lack of infrastructure and follow-through. Of course, the Democrats just needed to get it together. My friends, I don't know why this happened. And I doubt that there will be a satisfying narrative for years. It takes a long time for history to make sense. And I'm not going to try to make sense of a Tuesday on a Sunday in any grand moral arc of the universe sort of way. What I am going to do is tell you some things that I currently believe to be true. Now, as I list these things, I am open to being wrong about almost all of them. However, on this first statement, I do not envision any information or argument that will sway my firm belief. The first thing that I believe to be true is we must love, protect, and support the most vulnerable people among us and those beyond these walls. And this group includes trans people, especially trans children and their families, migrants, especially those who are undocumented, and low or no income people, especially low income women and people who can become pregnant. All the statements that follow must be understood as assuming this first statement. Now, number two, we don't know what's coming. So we must remain clear-eyed, honest, and realistic. Now, I'm not going to predict how far into authoritarianism or toward fascism the second Trump administration will take us. I do not know which of Trump's most extreme statements he and his oligarchs will attempt to enact. Yes, I believe in Maya Angelou's famous insight that when someone shows you who they are, you should believe them. But she pointedly says shows you, not tells you, as people's actions so frequently speak louder than their words. And Trump has shown us over and over again that he lies, that he exaggerates for effect, that he says things he has no intention of following through on. Of course, he is petty and self-aggrandizing, so I would be surprised if he didn't do or try to do some of the frightening things that he said he was going to do, but he also wants to be popular. So I'd be equally surprised if he tried to follow through on all of them. Besides, supposedly, the Constitution prevents actual dictators from taking over the country. But we've seen, of course, so many things we thought could never happen here over the past 8 years that it is hard to trust those guardrails. Still, we must be honest about what is actually happening in our government so that we can respond effectively. If we cry fascism over policies or actions we simply don't like, we will not be able to engage effectively with the country as it is, and we will further alienate others. On the other hand, if militarism or racist nationalism does increase on a governmental scale, then we will not be able to respond if we are in denial about it or desensitized to it. Being honest and clear-eyed is often not easy, but we must strive to be so going forward. Three. We must work with the country we have, not the country we wish we had. Now, in yoga, we talk about working with the world as it is, not as it used to be or as we wish that it was. For instance, and please forgive this wildly trivial metaphor given the circumstance, but bear with me. So say I want to do a yoga pose. I want to reach above my head and grab my foot like that. But I don't have the flexibility to do so. Say I saw a picture of someone in this perfected, fully expressed pose, and I wish I could emulate the beauty. Say I even used to be able to do it, like in my 20s, but not anywhere near now. Well, I could injure myself trying to create the image of the pose as I have it in my head, or I could work with my body as it is and modify the pose to fit what is possible now and get the benefit of it where I am now. Progressives tend to have a vision of a perfect, expansive government that takes care of everyone with its saving bureaucracy. We think we should be able to fix all of society's problems by lobbying politicians, by making phone calls, and maybe attending a town hall meeting here or there, by voting the right people with right beliefs into office who will write legislation and construct social programs for us that will take care of everyone. Well, my friends, that's not going to happen. Not for the next 4 years, at least on a national scale. Now, don't get me wrong. We must continue to be active in our government, especially our local government. And we must continue to work with our politicians, including finding common ground with moderate Republican politicians, as our wonderful lay minister, Darlene Thane, taught us a couple of weeks ago. But we must respond to the country that we have, not the one we wish we had. And for the next 4 years, we are going to have to do a lot of the work of caring, protecting, and healing ourselves with our bodies. We want to protect trans people, great. We got to do it. We want to protect migrants and women. We are not going to be able to count on this government to do it. We will have to partner with local organizers, get out into our neighborhoods, and make the change ourselves on a hyper-local scale. 4, I'm not going to tell us to keep fighting. I am going to tell us to keep working. War metaphors may be effective at firing people up, but they also inherently dehumanize anyone who isn't on your side. And your side can get more and more puristic and intolerant, rejecting anyone with even slightly heterodox opinions. And my friends, those of us on the left are gonna have to stop eating each other alive over mild transgressions and variations in opinion as well. But that is a sermon for another day. We have a remarkable amount of power in this country. But again, we have been conditioned to believe that it begins and ends with the vote. If we can just get the right people into office, then we can just sit back and relax. But that is not how it has ever worked, my friends. We have the most power in our own neighborhoods, in our own communities. This congregation has a remarkable amount of power in this city. We have been here for over 130 years. We have made local change before. We hosted a family in sanctuary for years, for crying out loud. That made a real difference in that family's life. We must look for more ways that we can take direct action in our neighborhoods to create the change we want to see. It might be on a smaller scale than we wished or dreamed of, but we must work with the world we have, where we have the most power. Do what we can with what we have where we are. 5, we are not living in unprecedented times. I know history has gone out of fashion in education in favor of STEM, but studying history, long history, my friends, not just the past 100 years, not just the past 250 years, has helped me feel less adrift the past 8 years. Governments that do not serve their people are not new. Civil unrest is not new. Feeling like this is as bad as things have ever been is not new. My friends, not everyone gets an easy age. But people have created great works of love, support, and compassion in every age. No matter how challenging it's been, there has never been a time in recorded history when things have been so bad that groups of people have not done beautiful, loving things that have made them a little better. And I don't think that Trump or we are unique enough that this is going to be the age that changes that. Francie Taylor reminded me this weekend of one of my favorite passages from Lord of the Rings. Frodo said, "I wish it need not have happened in my time." "So do I," said Gandalf. "And so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for us to decide. All we have to decide is what to do in the time that is given us." 6, We need to take care of ourselves and each other. We are not alone. Look around the room. You on Zoom, look at all the people in your chat with you. All these people are with you. We are still here. We will be here tomorrow. We will be here next year and the year after that. It takes a long time for history to make sense. In the meantime, we will respond to the world as it is and change it for the better. We will help history make sense. If there is no objective moral arc to the universe, we will create one in the spaces where we have influence. To do that, we need to take care of ourselves. Please, my friends, take care of yourselves this week, this month, this year. We can and will carry one another through, and we need all of us to do so. We will begin again and again and again, and we will work to build the world we want, starting in our neighborhoods, in our city. I am counting on all of you to stay with us. I am counting on all of you to stay connected. I am counting on you to do this work with us. My friends, will you do this with me?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. My friends, please stay risen in body or spirit for our closing hymn, Spirit of Life. It is number 123. May all beings be well. May all beings be content. May our actions be bonded to our deepest values. May we treat others as we would be treated. May we move through each day with compassion toward ourselves, our friends, and our enemies. May each breath bring us closer to our truest selves and to those we love. May it be so. My friends, I hope to see many of you at coffee hour right over there in Elliott Hall. And on our vigil, at our vigil on Wednesday, I told everyone to hug each other. And I'm going to tell you the same thing. Unless you're on the spectrum and hugs don't feel connecting to you, which is some people, if that is the case, you do what your version of hugging is. For my goddaughter, it's talking about Pokemon, if it's whatever it is for you. But if you are a hugging person, I invite you to hug one another because humans evolved to know other people are there through touch. And we need to know each other is there right now. I will be giving out hugs, and I encourage you all to give out hugs as well. See you over there.